You're listening to the audio production of True Riches, What Jesus Really Said About Money in Your Heart by John Cortines and Gregory Baumer, published by Nelson Books and read by Kirby Heyborne and Sean Patrick Hopkins. Please note that you may download an accompanying PDF that provides enhanced materials for this audiobook. To download the PDF, please visit thomasnelson.com/p/True Riches Audio. Foreword. Do you trust me? This is a big question from God that we must answer in every area of life. The Christian life is supposed to be lived by faith. In this book, John and Greg invite us to apply real faith and trust to our finances. They invite us to consider that trusting God and walking by faith could be the most joyful, adventurous, and eternally rewarding path we can follow with our money. This runs contrary to the popular belief, even in Christian circles, that managing money is all about responsibility, formulas, steps, and crafting a perfect plan. Those things matter, but they fall short of the full invitation of Jesus in this area of our lives. And at the end of the day, we are called to take new steps of faith on an adventure with God. My life verse is Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 through 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he will make straight your paths. This verse and the question of trust in God has defined my football journey. God never promised me success. He just asked me to trust him and walk with him day by day. He asked me to trust him when I broke my ankle as a high school quarterback, potentially ending my shot at getting recruited to play in college. He asked me to trust him when I had no scholarship offers at the end of my senior season in high school, and again when my prospects of becoming the starting quarterback at Michigan State appeared slim throughout my freshman and sophomore years. After a successful college career, I had hopes of being drafted to the NFL in the first or second round, but God asked me to trust him when I fell to the fourth round and got drafted to a team where I would surely be just a backup. It would be 3 years before I became the starting quarterback for the Washington Redskins. Through years of uncertainty and contract negotiations, I tried to always trust in God's sovereign control over my life. As this book goes to press, it is now my privilege to be the starting quarterback for the Minnesota Vikings. Through it all, God continues to invite me to trust him and walk in relationship with him each step of the way, in football and in life. The point of my football journey is not that trusting God brings amazing success. Rather, in success or failure, in great moments and in weak moments, my highest calling and opportunity is to grow in my walk with him. I've navigated life without much money as a college student, and am now navigating life with abundant finances. My wife Julie and I have learned to walk in a trusting relationship with God in this area of our lives. We firmly believe that money itself is neither good nor bad, but its use is highly spiritual. There are no easy answers, but there is a faithful God who invites us to humbly walk with him through every financial circumstance and decision. Here are a few lessons Julie and I have learned, lessons that are also woven into this book. God owns it all. Psalm 50. The power to make wealth comes from God, not ourselves. Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 18. Giving is an investment in eternity. Matthew chapter 6, verse 20. You can't outgive God. When I was 17, I heard Gary Haugen, the founder of International Justice Mission, IJM, speak on God's heart for bringing justice to the oppressed. I was moved and prayed that God would someday bless me with money so that I could invest in the amazing work of the organization. I could never have imagined that roughly a decade later, I would launch my NFL career in Washington, D.C., the city where IJM is headquartered. Being a part of IJM's work and the work of many other amazing ministries has been one of Julie's and my greatest joys. We pray that God might allow us to use all he gives us for his glory as we trust him day by day. May I never put my hope and security in a paycheck or a bank balance, but in God, who faithfully provides. I want to leave a legacy for him and his kingdom, and he calls you to the same. I know he has a plan for you and asks you to trust him in the ways that John and Greg will describe in the chapters to come. This book is an invitation to that journey of trust and faithfulness. May we all join together in this adventure with God. He asks each of us, "Do you trust me?" I pray that our hearts and lives will all answer with a resounding yes. Kirk Cousins, NFL quarterback. Introduction. Discovering true riches. Financial success is never as fulfilling as we think it will be. When money controls our decisions, we find momentary satisfaction but lasting discontent. When God controls our decisions, we find momentary challenges but lasting peace. God, in his grace, allowed me, John, to realize this at age 26, and my life has never been the same. I let go of money as the secret master of my life, and I discovered more adventure, deeper emotions, and a closer and more fulfilling fellowship with God than I had ever known to be possible. Until then, I had diligently followed every wise financial rule, even from childhood. I had saved up $10,000 mowing lawns in the blazing summer heat as a high schooler. I had studied hard to land a great job and earned six figures in my first year out of college. My wife and I tithed faithfully and saved like crazy, amassing $300,000 in savings by the time we were both 24. I headed to Harvard Business School in further pursuit of this financial mission and successfully landed an offer for my post-MBA dream job. After graduation, my wife and I would be headed overseas, where I'd earn more than $300,000 per year. We planned to save up enough money so that when we came back to the United States, we could pay cash for a house and avoid a mortgage altogether. But then, in his mercy and goodness, God started revealing to me the emptiness of my life in pursuit of money. Sitting in our Boston apartment on a cold, snowy day, I slowly read the 12th chapter of Luke's gospel over and over, and the words of Jesus pierced my heart. I began to realize that even though I had met every financial goal I had ever set, I was chasing the wind. I felt God asking me if I would consider a different kind of life, a life of joyful freedom, deep sacrifice, and heartfelt trust. In the months after that wintry day I spent with Luke chapter 12, my wife and I prepared to change our life trajectory forever. At first, we thought we would still take my dream job, go overseas, and begin giving half of our earnings away instead of saving so aggressively. But in a clear and compelling way, God began to reveal that he wanted us to abandon our dreams and instructed me to take a job with a small nonprofit organization instead. It meant a 65% pay cut. It meant student loans and a mortgage for the next decade or two instead of being debt-free. It meant that we couldn't send our kids to elite private schools, and it could mean career suicide. But God was relentless and clear that this was his plan. As we wrestled with God, we asked him big questions. Why would you call us away from our dream that we worked so hard for? Can we really trust you? Why do we feel upset, even angry, even in the midst of truly following your call? We counted the cost of following Jesus, and the cost was high. But we also couldn't deny what we were being called to do. So we paid the cost in broken dreams, tears, and countless moments of doubt. It wasn't quite like the fairy tale stories of discipleship where, after a bold step of faith, sunshine and rainbows erupt everywhere as we joyfully sing praise songs. Instead, while we knew we were squarely in the middle of God's will, we felt isolated, spiritually attacked, and alone for 2 full years. But we eventually discovered that the joy of walking with God is worth any price we might have to pay. In hindsight, my wife and I can now say that we have experienced the rich abundance of a life of intimacy with Him. We wouldn't trade our journey of surrender for anything else. The conversation we're not having. I didn't realize until later on that, in leading me away from a high-paying job overseas, God had actually been protecting me. Unknowingly, I had made an idol out of stability and security, and deep down I believed that financial success was a hallmark of a life well lived. Often in the Bible, however, financial success is seen in a mixed light. It's a blessing from God, yes, but it's also tremendously dangerous. In fact, Jesus said it would be very difficult for financially successful people to gain access to His kingdom. By asking me to lay down my financial stability, God was teaching me that my personal worth as a human being did not come from my financial net worth. Because of my hardness of heart, it was a lesson He needed to teach me the hard way. Unfortunately, despite my Christian upbringing, I was never taught about financial issues in church. Real, honest dialogue about faith and finances is rare. For some reason, the two seem to be allergic to each other. We typically don't talk about money with our spiritual mentors or think about our faith when we're paying off a student loan or buying a house. On the rare day that we learn about money in church, we usually hear about a formulaic life plan that looks something like this: get out of debt, achieve home ownership, save for retirement, live a comfortable, secure life, just be sure to give 10% of your income away, follow this path faithfully, and you'll become stable and secure, maybe even rich. This formula basically teaches us to do exactly what the culture around us does, with a special emphasis on staying debt-free and giving 10% away. It puts a nice Christian halo over the American dream. This is the formula I had been following, thinking I was being a great Christian role model with my financial life. But when my friend Greg and I started looking more closely at the teachings of Jesus, we could not find a single reference to anything like this formula, despite how frequently He taught about money. We had a hunch that something was missing. To validate this hunch, we conducted a formal survey of the 80 most knowledgeable experts we could find on this subject. The list included seminary professors, business leaders, stewardship pastors, senior pastors, financial advisors, and ministry leaders, many of whom have spent their whole lives studying and teaching what the Bible says about money. Specifically, we asked these leaders if they were satisfied with how the typical churchgoer is equipped with a biblical perspective on money. The result? Only one of them answered yes. In elections, a 60% vote is considered a landslide victory. In this case, we had 99% of experts agreeing that things are not going well when it comes to our understanding of God and money. This is an oversight with far-reaching consequences. We Christians desperately need a firm foundation for faith and finances, or we risk missing out on the fullness of all that God has for us. Greg and I wrote this book in hopes of making a small contribution toward this much-needed conversation. We've tried to build a firm foundation of content rooted in the teachings of God. We've also formatted this book so it is easy to journey with others and to stir up conversations among those who feel they can't find contentment or peace, no matter how good they get at saving or living responsibly. If your church gave you this book, It's because they want to become a place where people can learn life-giving truths about money, overcoming the isolation and disappointment that are all too common. Ultimately, this is for people willing to go after the treasure of the kingdom of God. Are you willing to abandon everything you thought you knew about money and stewardship in pursuit of the overflowing joy Jesus offers? You may not need to change careers like I did, but we hope this book can light the way as you consider embracing Jesus.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.